This edition of iItaly TV is sponsored by Colavita, extra virgin olive oil. And Cheerio chopped tomatoes.
On this episode, New York's best restaurants of Italian quality, followed by a stroll in New York with musician Mauro Pagani, then Italian writer Alessandro Baricco on his new book, plus a look at some events with a check into the calendar, all on iItaly New York.
Italiani americani, we are here at the Manhattan Pavilion with Mr. Claudio Bozzo. So Mr. Bozzo, tell us about the event tonight.
Oh, so the event is a celebration. What we are celebrating is we are celebrating Italian gastronomy done with the right ingredients. And these are the restaurants that actually have achieved the sign of quality. So we inspect the kitchen, we look at the menu, and then we certified after three or four of these inspections that we do. This event was organized by the Italian American Chamber of Commerce and under the umbrella of Union Camera.
How many restaurants are here today to represent the Italian cuisine?
Alors, we have the 40 restaurants that have been certified this year.
They will all receive a plaque, right, today?
They received the plaque this morning. We had the award celebration and we gave each of them, it's basically a very beautiful plaque that they can put outside the restaurant is the emblem of quality, obviously. So.
Today, many head of state is coming to New York, and there are so many events tonight, also Italian events, but this is the event where to be, because it's a fantastic event. It's incredible.
Let's go to take a look around and to discover the Italian cuisine together.
This vodka is made in Italy. It's made of semolina wheat. We use the same water as San Pellegrino. Our vodka goes through crushed marble, which is a very antique Venetian technique. You should try.
Riccardo, finally you're here! What are you doing?
Just checking the new magazine, and about here I like to have some amazing food from Liguria, some wine and the new vodka. I have never seen that before. Take me
okay,
there.
Come on. We have here Porchetta from Naples. So can you tell us what is exactly Porchetta from Naples?
The porchetta napoletana is typical in the, what I do in the Grano Trattoria. I have a brick oven, so I braise the porchetta for 4 hours with garlic, salt, pepper, and some rosemary. And it gets so, just so beautifully tender.
Can I try it?
Absolutely. What did you bring for us today?
So today here we represent Le Cirque in three different ways. So we have Osteria del Circo, which is more traditional, and we made panzanella. Mm-hmm. Panzanella is a rustic, authentic Tuscan salad. After we have Sirio Ristorante, we have a little bit more Italian contemporary, and we make vitello tonnato. And then we have for Le Cirque, we have a mini donuts, mini bomboloncini we call, which are very, you know, it's our own recipe since 35 years, and we still have on the menu, and it's still one of our really signature desserts.
Why is the quality brand so important?
It gives to all of us who are been trying for many years to bring the authentic Italian food to New York the opportunity to showcase our work.
What does it mean for like an entrepreneur like you to have a restaurant in New York which is authentically Italian and also authentically Neapolitan as well?
Well, it means a lot of research. We start from studying the tradition and selecting what we can really think we can be reproduced in New York. Viva Napoli!
Jam. Heirloom tomato jam. We grow our heirloom tomato in South New Jersey from Zio, only for Zio restaurant. And we make jam.
And what do you use this for?
Breakfast, dishes, appetizer. We combine a lot of things with that.
So what do you have today?
Today we have a Parma prosciutto roll filled with fresh figs, roasted pepper, and goat cheese. Finish it with vino cotto. And extra virgin olive oil.
That's vanilla panna cotta, the caramel peach compote, and peach and olive oil cake. Cream, milk, sugar, gelatin.
Why did you decide to bring this dessert today?
Yeah, it's a creation. We have it on the menu as a special right now. It's very seasonal, so.
Olive oil cake just really, I think, showcases the obviously Italian olive oil that we use.
Then we go to the gym together.
I want to know, what are you doing here? Are you enjoying? Are you eating a lot?
In Italia la cosa bella non è che bisogna mangiare molto, bisogna mangiare bene. E questa sera si può mangiare molte volte molto bene. E questo grazie a un bellissimo progetto che vede i ristoranti italiani di New York diventare i promotori dell'Italia in tutti i sensi.
How this idea came about?
Beh, io credo che vendere le emozioni italiane sia un dovere, non solo un'idea geniale da mettere in moto, da mettere in campo. È una iniziativa che sarà ripetuta, credo, in ogni angolo del mondo.
There are people that say that Italy is a old country, and I would add to that it's a old country, but there's always something new to propose. Do you agree with that?
Ovviamente. Noi abbiamo una capacità di creazione anche di nuovi prodotti, inserendo nuovi processi, che è straordinaria.
Dish from Naples, not the usual pizza, but we have gatto di patate. What is this?
Typical Napolitan dish made with a potato. It's a smashed potato with the ham and cheese, and then baked in the oven. And it's a potato pie.
But I know that in your restaurant, we don't only eat.
We have fun. No matter what we do, we have fun. So we eat, we drink, we watch soccer.
We took over an historic location. It used to be the Café des Artistes. So now the Café des Artistes speaks Italian, so it's the Leopard des Artistes.
What's the typical dish?
A specialty is from south of Italy, so the Regno to Sicily. And this evening we prepare an unclassic dish, which are zucchine parmigiana with the smoked provola.
With two wonderful guys, PT. What does this mean?
It's supposed to be telegraphy. Yeah. Yes.
Okay. And why this name?
It's
She's excited. Like, she never been in television, so she's a bit excited. I want you to tell me, what do we have here?
Okay, here we have pasta malareddus with tomato sauce and sausages. And before here, it was artichokes and sausage.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. And it's typical from Sardinia?
Yes. Yeah. Exactly.
Abbiamo visto tantissime cose innovative, ma torniamo un po' alla tradizione. Questa signora sta facendo orecchiette fatte in casa.
Si fanno con tutto semolina, con l'acqua calda, dopo che l'impasto si riposa e dopo...
Wanna try it?
L'hai bocciata!
Perché Mauro Pagani viene a New York? Viene a stare per periodi anche abbastanza lunghi a New York.
Questa è una città pervasa dai contrasti molto forti, ma pervasa di bellezza. È un posto bellissimo dove stare, dove si ha questa sensazione continua di... Almeno io avverto come una specie di ronzio continuo, di delle cose che vanno, le cose che si muovono, delle cose che succedono. Che tu sei sicuro che da qualche parte della città stanno succedendo e infatti se non stai attento dopo un po' ti prende l'ansia di perderti qualcosa e quindi sei sempre un po' in giro a vedere, vado di qui, vado di là, ma ci sarà qualcosa, mi sarò perso quello, mi sarò perso questo. E questo è un po' il fascino fantastico di questa città.
Dove hai trovato la musica?
Mia madre a un certo punto ha confessato che non sapevano cosa farmi fare perché pare che fossi una peste, quindi avevano un amico che suonava il violino e quindi mi hanno mandato lezioni di violino, ma se questo qua avesse suonato trombone, putipù, caccavello, non so cosa, mi avrebbero mandato a studiare quello. Sono figlio di musicista, mio padre era un bravissimo musicista dilettante di quelli che suonavano nelle bande di paese, lavorava in fabbrica comunque, tornava a casa la sera, studiava flauto. Una o due volte all'anno, specialmente la notte di Natale, io, il mio maestro, mio padre e un altro signore andavamo a suonare e facevamo un po' tutto il repertorio da Schumann a Handel a Vivaldi o queste cose. Poi verso i 15-16 anni è arrivato il rock and roll e lì ho deciso che quella era la mia strada e quindi c'erano queste lotte con mio padre che già non voleva che suonassi, in più assolutamente no alla chitarra, quindi sono proprio dovuto scappare di casa come nella migliore tradizione. Mi sono spostato a Milano e facevo il dancing, la balera, ho fatto il nightclub anche con le spogliarelliste, con la giacca di lamé. Poi a un certo punto ho incontrato quattro ragazzi che già facevano il mestiere da tempo, erano già un gruppo che faceva dischi, si chiamavano quelli, ci siamo messi insieme, abbiamo cambiato nome, abbiamo fatto il primo disco e è andato subito primo in classifica, era la premiata Forneria Marconi. Di colpo ovviamente tutto è cambiato, insomma. Sono stato un uomo molto fortunato per gli incontri che ho fatto. La PFM è stato un incontro, un altro incontro fondamentale ovviamente è stato di André. E fortunato perché ci siamo incontrati al momento giusto. De André era pronto a cambiare. Io erano 6 o 7 anni dopo la PFM, forse 8, che mi dedicavo esclusivamente alla musica del Mediterraneo. E quindi ero pronto a trasformare questo lavoro in canzoni. E quindi quando abbiamo deciso di lavorare eravamo pronti. L'uno ad ascoltare l'altro. Scrivere una canzone è come scrivere una novella, no? Ha un suo prologo, ha dei personaggi. E anche quando non sono le parole che si muovono, ma sono le note, in fondo una composizione musicale è il racconto delle avventure di una nota. Tu parti e c'è silenzio, poi cominci a muovere le mani, si muove l'aria e questo racconto comincia, no? Perché la musica è una lingua con delle sue regole, no? Ha una sua sintassi. Muoversi in questa cosa con un senso di racconto ti aiuta. Sono tutte cose che ho imparato da grande e molte di queste le ho imparate da lui. Il diavolo in sé, se che fai tu,
E scioltimo da pesce che esse da udrire a fontana di cumbi intaccare.
Come sei arrivato al Mediterraneo? Come ci sei passato? Anche perché poi magari da qui possiamo anche capire perché un uomo del nord a un certo punto fa il festival della Taranta, tanto da dove esce fuori.
Io dico sempre ridendo che sono il bresciano più terrone che c'è, perché di fatto io ho contratto questa malattia, questo amore per la musica mediterranea, per la musica popolare in genere, dalle mie frequentazioni milanesi. Da un lato in fondo ero rockstar in carica, no? Dall'altro lato però frequentavo il movimento, i musicisti del movimento, gli altri, no? Un po' questa frequentazione, un po' Demetrio Stratos, che era l'altro amico che frequentavo. Sai, alcune scintille, io piano piano ho cominciato ad andare in giro nei negozi di musica a cercare quello che si trovava allora molto poco, e spesso nel posto sbagliato, quindi nei contenitori del folk, in mezzo al liscio, gli yodel, eccetera, trovavi musica dell'Armenia, per assoluto caso. Ho cominciato a piacermi così tanto, e a un certo punto, quando io ho smesso con la PFM, io ho smesso di ascoltare rock. Io per 7-8 anni non ho ascoltato altro che musica mediterranea.
Grazie, arrivederci.
What does it mean for you to present your book translated in English here in New York?
For me it's a challenge. This is not a novel, it's an essay about this world, what's changing now in the cultural landscape here, like in Europe, like in Asia. So it's very difficult for an Italian writer to be published here. And for us it's easier put the tradition of food or drink or good living Italian, but the culture is difficult. For example, the book that is most popular by me here, that is Silk. And I remember very well that when it has been published here, I came here to make promotion, and most of the people believed that I was an Italo-American writer, because for them it was so unusual to read a book in translation. So, you know, we have to fight against this, and that's why we are here and we push a book together with music, with food, because that's Italy. But it's hard work.
Mutation of culture, like, do you think New York is like the symbol of this mutation of culture?
Not particularly. It's a mutation that is everywhere in the world, and you can find very important things in Asia or in Europe and United States too, but it's something that happened everywhere. When I speak about this book in South America or in Vietnam or in Israel, it's the same thing. Oh, everybody has the same feeling. Everybody knows exactly that something is happening, but nobody knows exactly what. So it's something that I think it's interesting for everybody in the world.
Thank you.
I am really grateful for everything that I was given the opportunity to do. And being the first lady of New York State was a grand thing. It was a great experience, a great adventure, and I am thrilled that I can still have the ability to do more to help our children stay in school. We still have problems with the Italian-American young people who do not stay in school through high school and then to college. They drop out. Education is the prevention and a key to success. Only good things happen when you become educated.
Who better than Matilda Kuo? And this is actually a perfect event to close a year of event that the Women's Forum of the Chamber has created. I'm very happy of the development is happening. Every country is looking at women to bring change. And we thought, as an Italian, let's say, association, which is the Chamber of Commerce, to also stimulate the women to help change our country too. And our Women's Forum is really doing that.
Mrs. Cuomo belongs to the New York crowds because she mainly worked here as a mother, as a wife, as a businesswoman, and as a first lady. One of the reasons also we chose her because she's the mother of the present governor, Andrew Cuomo. And her son could be very well one day our president in this country. And I think for us Italian-American Americans, that would be really wonderful.
2 years ago, they asked me to be the first woman to be recognized. It was a way to create a sort of networking among the women, the Italian women in New York. This is really something very beautiful, and I'm really very honored of being the first to be recognized, because after me, I had really outstanding personalities, Letizia Moratti first, and this year Matilda Cuomo. So it's really the proof that Italian women are really very, very strong and very present in New York.
This is a very important forum, and the person that is receiving the prize, the award this year, she is a true legend in the field of the care for women, care for the underprivileged. Matilda Cuomo is someone that is known throughout the world and we all respect immensely.
Gilda Mignonette, her real name was Griselda Andreattini, was a very popular singer back in the 20s. She was born in Naples, but then she moved to New York and she became an icon. She was extremely popular, and then at a certain point she had health issues, and then she wanted to go back to Italy to die in her hometown in Naples. But she died on the boat during the traversal. Several months ago, a dear friend and a great and eclectic Italian actress and singer, Marta Bifano, decided to pay tribute to Gilda Mignonette. And so she created an amazing theatrical production called Gilda Mignonette, La Regina degli Emigranti, The Queen of the Emigrants.
We study the history of emigration of the Italian all over the world, and every year we make an important international mission. We are promoting now an important international show all over the world, and we will make an important tournée in the next year, starting just from New York.
I think that the voice of this big singer was a part of his soul, and she expressed through the voice a big concept of the life.
Lo Studio dei Nipoti is an artist collective for U.S. artists of Southern Italian ancestry. Their works represent immigrant culture in the U.S. Dante Ferretti, Design and Construction for the Cinema, is presented with a six-month retrospective of 22 films featuring the production designer's career-defining work.
This edition of Italy TV was brought to you by European Flavors, promoting organically grown fruits and vegetables in the best European tradition. And Baci Perugina Chocolates, say I love you the Italian way.